الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، صدق الله العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ذو شيطان. Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home, continuing from where we had left off in the last session of Darsi Hadith, after 30 hours of intense confrontation at the Battle of Siffin, it was finally agreed and ceasefire was in place with the terms and condition of an arbitration plan. And this only happened when the Syrians, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, had told the army to pick up the mushaf and tie it to their swords and show it to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an and his army. When Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an had seen the mushaf, immediately what he did is that he said to his army, his group of people, to throw the weapons down immediately. And when they threw their weapons, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala also announced, and the weapons were all thrown down. This was the ceasefire, and the fight had stopped immediately when the Mus'haf, the Quran, was shown to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now again, it's a very sensitive issue. Hazrat Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, a senior sahabi of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and of course we all know of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, both of them senior companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we won't repeat what we have already covered in explanation as to why this confrontation occurred. And all of them were sincere. It was only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just to explain how difficult it was, such a mishmash for Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, that many that were with Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an were from amongst the rebels who had actually murdered Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an. And of course what they wanted to fight the Syrians and the army of Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an. Their wish was to completely vanquish the Syrians. Why? Because it was Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an who was at the forefront demanding the laws of Qisas, that the murderers of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an should be brought to justice and all of them should be also killed according to the Islamic justice system. And so their fear was Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, and they did not agree when Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an responded to the proposal that came from Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an, and for that immediate ceasefire. So they came to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, the rebels, and they said to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, that the decision you have taken is wrong. Being a Khalifa, you have to follow the Quran, and you can't just compromise with the Syrians and Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala and rejected all their proposals. And so what they did is that they said to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala that we will also defect from your army and go against you. So now one minute they were with Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, these were the Sabai sect, the hypocrites that instigated the battle of the camel also, the Sabai sect. And so they pulled off and they said to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, we can't be with you. The decision that you have taken is un-Quranic, unconstitutional. And so it is wrong for you. Allahu Akbar. And so when this group moved out from Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, in the annals of Islamic history, a new title is given to this particular group of people who are known as the Khariji sect. You have the Murji'a and now you have the Khariji sect. The Khariji sect have been prophesied by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the Khariji will be a community of Arabs, well versed in the Arabic language. And if you were to look at them, you will be amazed of the intensity in worship, how they would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outwardly. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they will miss Islam like how an arrow would miss the target. They would miss Islam like how an arrow would miss the target. And in another narration, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks of the Khariji sect. And he said that close to the time of Qiyamah, you will have the youth of my ummah who will speak very eloquently and who will portray themselves to be great scholars and learned people, that they know everything. And when they speak, they will satisfy anyone. And so Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, be careful. They will also miss Islam like how an arrow will miss the target. Today we see the prophecy of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming true. Many of the people, totally illiterate, the only source of knowledge is the internet, or perhaps from the app, an iPhone, they might have one tafsir of the Quran or the Sahih Muslim translated, or the Sahih Bukhari translated in Arabic. And that is the only source of knowledge. And when they want knowledge, the intention is that so that they can argue with people. So they're not even sincere in their knowledge. Because knowledge will make you humble. Knowledge will make you humble. But on the contrary, their knowledge will make them arrogant. And they will want to argue and argue and argue and argue and argue. And so be careful of such individuals. And so Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks of this Khariji crew that emerged during the time of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala and they gave a lot of difficulty to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala and imagine they came to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala and they said to him that innal hukmu lillah, innal hukmu lillah, that everything should be ordained by the Quran. And the decision that you have taken to compromise with your brother, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala, is against the law of the Quran. And so they separated. So it was a very difficult moment for Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala and also for Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. Their intentions were clear. Each one of them wanted to search for and identify these individuals who were in their hundreds, if not thousands. The rebels that came and entered Madinatul Munawwarah. And even implicitly had something to do with the murder of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. So it was difficult for Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. Again, we have to be very, very careful. It's not just something when we talk about history, just to quickly flick over the pages and just talk about the companions. When you read the books about the Battle of Siffin, it's only when you do your research that you find out how much corruption and fabrication that is there. and how much influence of the Shia sect there is upon even the Sunni sect, and how the books that are written. So for an example, you'll find that in some of the books when they talk about the Battle of Siffin, it is mentioned that Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu during the Battle of Siffin, after every salah, would curse Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and the Syrians. So this was the doing, aliyazu billah, of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. So after his salah, he would curse. And Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu would do the same, aliyazu billah. And what he would do is, after his salah, he would curse Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Hazrat Hassan and Hazrat Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhumah. And again, these are the reports that you'll find in many of the books, which are a total fabrication and ideas that have been concocted by Shia and the Rawafid. In fact, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu had the greatest respect for Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. All of them were companions by Allah. Subhanallah, how can we even talk about such individuals? The scribes of the Quran, Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala, the son-in-law of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so what you read, you have to be very, very careful, my respected brothers and elders. Now in this narration, in the chain of narrations where people talk about this, that each sahabi was cursing one another, there is a man whose name is Abu Makhnaf. Abu Makhnaf. And if you look at the life of Abu Makhnaf, Abu Makhnaf was an extreme Shia, was an extreme Rawafid, Ghali Shia. And it is of no surprise that when you have Abu Makhnaf in the chain of narration, for him to speak such evil in matters of Sahaba-i Kiram Ajma'in. And in truth, they had no respect also for Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. But finally, alhamdulillah, the Battle of Siffin is a very sensitive issue, and it ended with the proposal of an arbitration plan. And so the arbitration plan that was put in place was by Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. An arbitration plan would mean that someone would be appointed by Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala, and someone would be appointed by Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, and the two individuals would look into the good of, or the common good for the Muslims, and resolve the matter immediately. This was their intention. And so Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala chose Hazrat Musa Ashari radiallahu ta'ala. Who did he choose? Hazrat Musa Ashari radiallahu ta'ala as his arbitrator. And Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala chose Hazrat Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala. And it was decided that during the month of Ramadan, in the location of Dawmatul Jundul, both the arbitrators would sit and decide and take the views of the Syrians and also those that were with Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. And the main matter to discuss was, what are we to do with the rebels who have murdered Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. You see, everything that started, all started after the shahadat of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. Everything is connected to that. The Battle of the Camel, the Battle of Siffin, everything is all about Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala, and to avenge the blood of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala, that in the Islamic Khilafat, it would be unlawful for the rebels and the murderers of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala to walk around freely. And so this was the difficulty. And so the arbitration, inshallah, will take place. But again, unfortunately, what happens is that there is so much Shia influence, and I say this very openly, so that it should be the knowledge of every Sunni Muslim here, that there is so much Shia influence in matters of the Battle of Siffin and the Battle of the Camel, because the Shias only have this as their main proof to show the world, in fact to deceive the world, that look what is happening with the companions, Aliyazu Billah, and missing out from their sincerity. So they actually thrive at these incidents that occur, the battle of the Jamal, the battle of the Camel, and also the battle of 15. And so Aliyazu Billah, again you see whenever you talk about these two arbitrators appointed, you will find that even Muslim historians who are mildly Sunni, and I say mildly Sunni, because every historian does not mean that he is a great scholar. A historian would only mean to record the information that he has got or his own research. A Muslim historian does not mean that he is a great scholar and that he has the knowledge of tafsir, or that he has the knowledge of the hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or that he understands the standing of the companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you'll find a lot of mildly moderate Sunni Muslims who don't have a lot of knowledge. Unfortunately, perhaps the style of how it is written, very charismatic, the way the books have been written, and so they have this tendency that they have recorded all sorts of narrations and reports also in their books, which does not justify when you look at the status and the ranking of Sahaba-i Kiram Ajma'in. So for an example, one point which is very important, they say that Hazrat Musa al-Ashari, that was appointed by Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he was again a soft-hearted individual and a heedless individual, a man who could be deceived very quickly. And they say that Hazrat Amr ibn al-As was a crafty individual, astaghfirullah. And so what he did is that he tricked Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala, disrespecting both the companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Musa al-Ashari and also Hazrat Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala an. And so, mashallah, we need to be very clear. Who are these historians to shed ink upon these great companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has announced in every chapter of the Quran, radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an, radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an, radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an, that I am pleased with the companions and the companions are pleased with me. I am pleased with the companions and the companions are pleased with me. And so you have to be very, very careful, my respected brothers. That is why gossip, rumors, there is no bounds to that. Imagine, never mind the companions, the hypocrites during the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam actually accused Bibi Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha al-iyazu billah of having an affair with a sahabi. Can you imagine that? And this continued. And these are the type of Allahu Akbar, the filth that is also written by many individuals, al-iyazu billah, which started off by the munafiqeen. So from day one, where you have good individuals, where you have people who want to present Islam in the right manner, you always have an opposition party. Always the party from shaitan. And so if they could not spare Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, then who is Hazrat Ali and who is Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala? And in fact, who is Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha? When Aliyazu Billah, they even accused Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam, the prophets who were pure, completely pure and infallible human beings. And so mashallah, as Sunni Muslims, our understanding should be very, very clear, and we should not doubt any of the companions. But alhamdulillah, it is good, it is a source of knowledge that we understand that they even criticized Hazrat Musa al-Ashari, and they criticize Hazrat Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu ta'ala an. Now before we cover the points of arbitration, I don't think that will be possible in our session tonight, maybe in the next session, but it's important that we look into the brief biography of each of the companions. And alhamdulillah, that has been the pattern all the time. Whenever we speak of any sahabi, we also give a brief account of that individual, so that alhamdulillah we have that love and affection for every sahabi that is there. Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiyallahu ta'ala is a senior sahabi of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, connected to the tribe of Tamim, a man who was very learned and perhaps the best qari amongst the group of companions. The best qari. A man when he would read the Quran, subhanallah, and we'll cover that. It is said that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam was once with Hazrat Buraida radiallahu ta'ala just at the door of the masjid. And in the night there was this man reading beautiful Quran in the masjid. And so Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Hazrat Buraida that, do you think this man who is reading Quran to show off? So Hazrat Buraida radiallahu ta'ala said, Ya Rasulallah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah and His Rasul have the knowledge. I have no knowledge. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, no. This man is a sincere, devout Muslim, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed him with beautiful qiraat and beautiful voice. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that from amongst my ummah, the voice of Dawood alayhi salam is given to this individual. The voice of Dawood alayhi salam is given to this sahabi. Hazrat Buraida radiallahu ta'ala an says that I was waiting to see who this individual is. And so when he came out, I saw that it was Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala an. In another narration, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that he has been given the voice of Dawood alayhi salam. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that I was listening to your qiraat. And so Hazrat Musa al-Ashari said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, had I known that you were listening to my qiraat, I would have made a lot of effort to read even more beautiful Quran to please you. Even more beautiful Quran to please you. Our Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wassalam is given the best voice. The best voice. It is said that in Jannah, maybe I can use the term a reception party. A reception party. So you see, in Jannah everything is halal. Mishnah, listening. He's had too many burgers yesterday, so we won't open that. But anyway, a reception party. And so when you enter Jannah, the malaika will be saying, Salamun, Salamun, Mashallah, come to Jannah, and they'll show you everything. And sort of an entourage of beautiful creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beautiful individuals that will be there in Jannah. And not to forget the Hurayin, of course, and everybody that will be there. And then Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wassalam, mashallah, will be told to read the qiraat of Zabur in front of the people of Jannah. And Dawood alayhi salatu wassalam will read the qiraat of Zabur in front of the people of Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah. By the barakat of Masjid Umar, and that we are sitting in the house of Allah talking about great individuals and the Quran in front of us. It is said, and this is in Suratul Anbiya, very quickly I've opened the page. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَخَّرْنَا مَعَ دَاوُودَ الْجِبَالَ يُصَبِّحْنَا وَالطَّيْرِ وَكُنَّا فَاعِلِينَ. Dawood alayhi salatu wassalam was given such beautiful voice that even the birds would stop flying. The birds would stop flying and they would hover above the head of Dawood alayhi salam to listen to his qiraat. Allahu Akbar. And such beautiful voice that when he would do the zikr of Allah, Allah says that yusabbihna, that even the mountains would echo the same tasbih of Dawood alayhi salam joining him in glorifying Allah. So if he would say, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, the mountains would say, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. This is again the miracle and the mu'jiza of this great Nabi Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. And so from amongst the companion, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Subhanallah, that the voice of Dawood alayhi salam is given to Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala. That is why Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala in his gatherings would ask Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala to come, and he would say that before we continue, I want you to recite the Quran. I want you to recite the Quran. This is a mu'jiza. In one narration by Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala would say, before Nabuwat, before prophethood was given to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when I would walk with him to the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah, we would not pass any tree, any boulder, mountains, but every tree, every stone, and every mountain, every tree would greet Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam and would make salam to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So even the mountain would say, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. That may the peace and greetings and salutations be upon you, ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why? Because Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam at that time was in front of the tree, was in front of the mountain. And so this is the manner of how you greet. So this mu'ajizah was also given to Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala was an incredible sahabi. Someone who was very close to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. On one occasion, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to the companions, and subhanallah, what a Nabi, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Kaise Nabi thi. How much love he had for this ummah. Mawlana Abdul Rahim Sahib in Masjid Ali was saying that like not perhaps not even a father could display such love for his own child, like how Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam would display love for his ummah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam told the ummah that before you sleep, wipe your bedding. Now imagine such subtle information. Wipe your bedding with your hands, clean it. Zara jardo, in case there's anything there. Huh? Before you put on your shoes, shake it properly, in case there's anything inside that you can't see. Subhanallah. How to drink water? Sit down and drink. Don't sip everything in one shot. Sip it 3 times. Breathe every time you, mashallah, take one sip, and then take time, and then again. Take time, and then again 3 times. Do it in this manner. These were the teachings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he would actually show love to the companions. So once he said to the companions, bring for me water and a vessel, a container, a large container filled with water was presented to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam's wuzu was different to our wuzu. See, when we do wudu, if you splash to someone who's sitting close to you, he'd look at you and give you a mean look. Ghusl kar raha hai kya? Do your wudu, don't make me do your wudu. Do your wudu, don't make me do your wudu. But in the case of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his wudu was very different. Not a single drop of water would fall to the ground. So he would do wuzu, wash the face, wash the hands, and he would want every drop of water that has touched his body to trickle back into that container. So if he would gargle, if he would rinse his mouth, everything would be splashed back into that container. If he would wash his face, the water was collected into that container. If he would wash his hands, the water is collected into that container. This is the difference between the wuzu of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the wuzu of the common followers of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so he did wuzu and he washed his face and he washed his hands, and he said to Hazrat Musa al-Ashari that Musa come here. And Hazrat Musa al-Ashari came and he said that I have washed my hands and I have washed my face. And in one narration, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam's saliva was also mixed with that water, as in he gargled. And so all that water was collected, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, drink from this water and put some water on your head and put some water on your chest. Allahu Akbar. What a sahabi. That was the love that he had for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this to Hazrat Musa al-Ashari, it is said that Hazrat Umme Salama, the wife of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was in her hujra, in her chamber. And she could actually hear the conversation between Hazrat Musa al-Ashari and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hazrat Umme Salama also said to Hazrat Musa al-Ashari, that, oh great companion, don't deprive me also. Save me some water and also give me some water. So that Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala and used some water. And some water he gave to the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala. Many narrations. There is one narration of Hazrat Musa al-Ashari that a group of people with him were on a journey with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as they climbed up a hill, some of the companions loudly were saying, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Oh, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the companions, you are not calling upon someone who is deaf or someone who is absent from you. And then he looked at Hazrat Musa al-Ashari, who was part of that group, and said, Musa al-Ashari, come to me, radiallahu ta'ala. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, shall I not inform you a tasbih which is from the treasures of Jannah? Kanzum min kunuzil Jannah. From amongst the treasures of Jannah. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him the tasbih of La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The tasbih of La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Kanzum min kunuzil Jannah. And so mashallah, if you have time, 100 times, ye tasbih aadmi kar le. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Kanzum min kunuzil Jannah. That is the ranking and the position of Hazrat Musa al-Ashari. And how dare anyone, Allahu Akbar, take the status of the companions lightly, reviling their position. Hazrat Amr ibn al-As and Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala an. And let it be known that Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an was a man who was very meticulous in selecting governors. And the best governor during the Khilafat of Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab, scholars have mentioned, was Hazrat Musa al-Ashari radiallahu ta'ala. And he was extremely close to Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. And that is why, my respected brothers, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an saw nothing wrong with him and appointed him as his arbitrator. A sahabi, and Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala an selected Hazrat Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala an, so that both of these great companions could sit and perhaps quickly come to a resolve, because things were getting very, very difficult for Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. Now the Sabai sect have taken a new label and a new title, a new name, which is Khariji. Which is Khariji. And so this is again a new group which we will discuss in the sessions to come. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq that we can understand Islamic history in accordance to the teachings of the guided scholars and the scholars of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jamaat, and that may we have deep love for all of the companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa maulana Muhammadin nabiyil ummi wa ala alihi wa sallim taslima. Allahumma taqabbal minna wa tub alayna innaka anta tawwabur rahim. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.